So, probably you realize that the algorithm used in the operating system is fighting with the resource and fairness. So these two things, how to share the limited resource, and also how to increase the satisfaction. Okay, that's the two important things. So we will, before we start the main part of the operating system, this week and next week, we will mostly talk about the introduction and the operating system and computer architecture. So we discuss a lot what is the operating system. It's a program itself. Some of the, especially for undergraduate students, they thought the operating system is something different. Sometimes when I ask such a question, what is the operating system? They believe this kind of hardware. But it's nothing but the software program. It should be compiled and it has a bunch of instructions that you learn in the microprocessor or machine computer architecture class. Okay. To do that, to understand the operating system, definitely you should have the knowledge or the idea of the computer system structure, computer architecture, okay? As you know, the computer consists of the hardware part and software part. The operating system belongs to the software part. And what about the hardware? Hardware you probably learn in the computer architecture. It has, as we discussed just before, it has the CPU memory and the I/O. These three are the main parts, and all devices are connected to the motherboard. Then we finish it. Also, we can separate the operating system from the application program anyway, even though they are the same software, they are the application, their purpose are different. So operating system is kind of system programming, okay? It's not, it doesn't serve directly to the user request, instead it serves for the other application, software program. So application program is running on top of such a system programming operating system. Then we have a user. When we are saying the user in the computer or the network or operating system, it doesn't have to be only the people or the human being. It can be other machine, other server, and other node. So what operating system can do? Operating system, as I said, is a coordinator, the limited resource. So I like the definition of the operating system, this one. An operating system is a program that control, okay? Control and coordinate the use of hardware resource, especially limited resource. If you have the unlimited resource, we don't have to actually coordinate. If we want, you can use it. But because we have limited resource, this is the main job of the operating system, unlike the definition. It explains everything that I talked so far. But some people are saying the operating system is a kernel program. Kernel program is a, what is a kernel program? It's the first program triggered by the BIOS program or the other firmware, the system program in the computer. Okay, so it's the first program. Once the kernel program is started, then kernel program can create the other processes. Some of them are critical processes, system processes, then eventually application process will be started. However, this is too small the definition. It's too strict. So I don't like that, because in addition to the kernel, there are many more, much more the process, system process that are required to operate the computer system. Okay? Sometimes some people said everything running on what the shipping with the computer will be operating system. Like the, for example, Windows. Windows include many applications, and they said, I think has been, there was a lawsuit regarding to the Internet Explorer, okay? The IBM, and not IBM, the Microsoft actually, the ship, the Windows, the operating system, 95, ME, Vista, and whatever, the Internet Explorer is included in their operating system. Is it fair with the other internet browser company? So there were lawsuits, then the Microsoft is fair. So there might be the option to select which the internet browser they use from like that. So everything is goofy. So that's the reason I like this definition. So when we already talk about the what happened the when computer startup, it will record first the BIOS program where sometimes it's a thumbnail program or BIOS program, whatever. They will check the all the devices in that consists of your computer, then they call the first program, which is a system kernel. Then these kind of the device will be checked by the BIOS program. Then eventually operating system will take care of this operating system. So I don't want to spend the time for computing architecture thing. So nowadays the modern, there are many different operating systems. The open source. It's a free software sometimes, like the Linux or the other operating system. Sometimes you need to pay a lot. So, but most of such a modern operating system is based on the Intel. So, somebody said it's an Intel-driven operating system. So that is the computer system operation, very important the operation. What is Intel? It's a time. It's interrupt. So you interrupt me. So I cannot proceed the lecture. Why? You have a question. Right? That's exactly the same thing in operating system. To make the long story simple, in operating, as I said, computer has limited resources. So you need to share. But what if you are my device? So all of them are busy. To check the email, to check the YouTube, your Facebook, but nobody focus on my lecture. Then I need to interrupt. Then send a signal, please. Then you will watch me. You stop the current job and wait for my direction or instruction. Okay, it's the same thing in computer. Computer, for example, the CPU is doing something. Then, unfortunately, CPU can process, if you have single core, okay, process one the set of the instruction. What if there is something program or the system device then needs CPU resource? At that time, you can send the interrupt signal. Okay, interrupt is the signal. When there is an event. Event means it can be input, it can be output event. It can be something unusual case. For example, a number divided by zero. Why divide by zero is unusual event? Computer cannot take care of it. It's forever. Right? If you divide one by zero, it's an infinite number. So if you do not stop, such a dividing by zero, computer will be crazy. It's gone. So you need to take care. So these are the events. So once there is an event, you need to interrupt. Stop. Please take care of the command, my request. Or this is an unusual event. You need to take care of this. Stop the process instruction. Otherwise, your CPU will be 100% the usage is a hang, something like that. So all this the operating system, the computer will be taken there by the operating system, which is interrupted. Okay. So we will discuss a little bit more later, but simply interrupt is the signal event to get the service of the resource. There is another thing, there is a 12 or exception. What is the, have you ever heard about the trap? But you heard about the exception a lot from Java program or the observative program, right? So you'd like to catch what? Something error, not only error, but sometimes event, special event. So you'd like to catch it. Once something happened, then you execute some other. It's the same thing. So interrupt is the usually by device, hardware, okay, or system. Trap is, as name implies, it's a trap. For example, divide by zero. So divide by zero actually can be done, but it's unusual. So computer cannot take care. You make the kind of trap. In case, such an unusual case, stop instruction right now, okay? Stop instruction. Then do something. Kill the process or the send the, a message to the user, something. Otherwise, your system will be hanged. So software, the kind software interrupt is called such an exception or trap. But basically, they are same mechanism. So nowadays, the modern the operating system is an interrupt-driven operating system. For example, this one shows the how interrupt is working along the time. So we have the two devices. The one is a CPU and another one is the I/O. So first time, the CPU is processing, okay? Then when the CPU is processing one instruction, sometimes you need to get the data from the memory, okay? At the time you request, you stop, and the request to the I/O device, it can be memory, it can be hardware, at the hard disk drive. In case of the hard disk drive, you need to request such a signal to the disk controller. By the way, what is a controller?
Manages these resources. This controller manages the...
So supposedly you have the hard disk drive. When you possess the hard disk drive, then I try to connect. You can use the hard disk drive to connect the bus pin or the, let's say, USB. When you connect to the USB, let's say it's a SCSI hard disk drive. So you connect this one to the SCSI controller. Okay? Then how your operating system, your computer recognize that this one, the new hard disk drive? Anyway, you need the software to use the any device, any hardware. It's like dummy without the program, okay? Without software. So you need the software to recognize this, okay? Where you can install such a software? In the controller. If you have the SCSI, the hard disk drive, you need to have SCSI controller. It has the 16, 15, the port, okay? You need to use one of them. Then, this SCSI controller has a software, or device program, or driver program. That's the reason. Nowadays, every device, most of the devices are standardized. So you don't have to install. But long time ago, when you purchase a new device, probably that device shipped with something program, right? And what floppy disk drive or hard disk drive. Nowadays, if there is no standard program for the new device, if you are connected, it's automatically downloaded and installed to this drive. Then this controller know how to handle the input and output in the, your computer and this one. So this the such a program is put by the manufacturer. Okay? This is a controller. Then when CPU is request the data to the I/O device, like the hard disk drive, okay, it interrupt and send the signal to the controller. And controller know how to access the data. Probably it will send the address of based on your operating system. We will learn such an address format. This device does not know. However, this controller convert some more high level. It's abstraction level. Okay? This one is a C drive and under whatever. But this one has low level address. The cylinder number 1, train number 2, and sector number 3. And find the data return to controller. Okay? That is the transfer here. And CPU, at the time CPU can process other instruction. Because I don't want to waste the CPU time, because CPU time is more simple. Then at this time, once the data is retrieved, so you know your controller know the data I is 1. This one should be returned to the CPU, right? Somewhere in the register. How can you do that? At the interrupt, send the interrupt signal, then CPU will be interrupt and transfer the data, process it. Okay. That is the interrupt-driven operating system. This is slide to show how it works around the time. So there are different types of the interrupt. So software and hardware. Mostly the interrupt is driven by hardware. In case of the software, it's called the track. So you can make in your program, like the exception code in the Java, you can make the, in your own program. So one of the reasons why we use the interrupt is we don't want to waste the CPU time. Because one, when the CPU adds the data to the I/O, actually CPU is idle. It's called the I/O wait. The CPU should wait until data is, nothing I can do, nothing CPU can do without the data, right? So wait. During that time, it's idle. So instead of just waiting without doing anything, so CPU change, actually operating system, change the job. So we have the program A. There's a series of instruction, program B, series of instruction. So this is I/O request, so wait. The CPU is idle. Why don't we switch over this one? Then process. So who is in charge of this? So operating system, scheduler. CPU scheduler. So we will discuss a lot the CPU scheduler because that is the most important the algorithm here. But such a CPU scheduler and algorithm are based on the interrupt and prep. So this is the, I think you can understand how it works. The first event, then the CPU stop. In case the CPU received the interrupt signal, stop the current job. And then you need to save the current status of the process where you process and what probably in your CPU you have the register information, register 1, register 2, I2, I3, something like that. This data should be copied, saved for next time. This is a stop, so you need to save this one and switch over and process this, and this time this one is a saved somewhere. Then once go back, you need to grow the such a data again, then process it. Also, once you receive the interrupt signal, you need to disable the interrupt. Otherwise, it will be interrupt again. Okay? Then, CPU store the related data, that means the same CPU state. Okay? Then, continue, resume the job. We will discuss each part we should discuss later, details. Okay? Then execute, resume the interrupt process, enable, then enable the interrupt. It can be interrupted by another the event. So I/O, I already explained the such an I/O structure. Mm-hmm. So in this I/O, you put that I/O device, the most important part is the hard disk drive. Okay, there are different types of the storage structure. As you know, it has the secondary storage, it's the non-volatile. Non-volatile means even though there's no power, it will not be gone. So that's the hard disk drive, that we have the external hard disk drive or the internal hard disk drive, that is the secondary storage. What is the first, the primary storage?
Yeah.
It's a memory. Okay? Memory is the primary storage. One, CPU access the data in the memory first. So primary storage. Then if CPU cannot find the data from the memory, it will go to the secondary storage. However, the main memory is volatile, which means without power, you cannot preserve the data. So it will be gone. However, nowadays, there's a solid state, the disk, or the memory, which is non-volatile, okay? But it's expensive. So this is the storage structure. We will discuss more in the chapter 9 through 13. There is, like, important part, caching. What is a cache?
Temporary memory.
Pre-processing. Cache is the algorithm, whatever, used for what?
To
reduce the gap between two devices in terms of speed. If one is fast, another one is slow, you can put the cache area, okay? Then the fast device can access the cache in between. If you cannot find the data and read to the cache, we have a similar one in computer structure, buffer. What is the difference between buffer and cache? It's quite similar. Buffer is used for fast media and slow media. So you put the buffer, right? For example, when you watch video streaming, you specify the size of buffer. What is that? What is the difference between buffer and cache? Yes?
The cache, if you can keep information until you have to delete it.
Mm-hmm.
The buffer is like a streaming. You
yes.
have to keep going.
Mm-hmm.
You have to.
Media.
Yes. Both of them are used for reducing the gap of the speed. But you have the fast and you have the slow. So instead of accessing the data directly to the slow, if you access the data directly, you may not get the full benefit of fast. So you put the more faster the media, but mostly expensive. Okay, then if data is accessed, you can keep. the buffer. Okay? And also, if first when the first media access the data, take a look at lookup whether there exists the data in the cache. If not, go and copy and delete. The idea is most frequently accessed data are small, okay, and also they are mostly accessed. Think about the database, because I'm teaching the database also. Database, one of the way of speeding up to search the data, query the data is, I probably mentioned about the cache, workflow management. So when a database accesses the data from the cache, the ratio between how many data are accessed and how many of them are from cache memory. This is called the heap ratio. So 50% means one out of two is retrieved from memory and the other one is from hard disk one. Okay. Usually the heap ratio in the database is 99/198, which means 99 out of 100 is from the memory cache. Only one or two is from hard disk drive. So high. Why is it so high?
It's continuously retrieved.
Even though you have the 1 terabyte data, how many of them are used currently? Only this much. The others are usually history data, never been accessed. Think about the Bank of America or the IBM. Even though they have the huge amount of Facebook, have you ever read the your message a year ago? The posted 1 year ago? No, most people do not. Just one or two times a year. So most frequent access data is this small amount. So usually there is a rule, 20 to 80. Only 20% of data are used, the others are just backup purpose. So idea is this one. So even though this is much smaller than the slower device, so we can get a very high heap ratio from the cache, from the memory. That is a cache. On the other hand, buffer is network stream. For example, 10 megabps, very high quality, the HD video stream. So probably this video data is transferred through your internet. Then I have the PC, but mine is 1 megabyte. Okay, the bandwidth. So in this, for real time to display the this media, we need a 10 megabyte, it has only 1 megabyte bandwidth. And how I have to watch 1 megabyte? Wait 10 seconds. Oh, 1 second? Wait the 10 seconds. 1 second. It's still not continuous. To address that one, we put the something area. That's true. So like 100 megabyte. Then we read from the buffer. Okay? So then we can reduce the gap of speed. That is a buffer. This question, what is the difference between buffer and the cache, is a frequently asked question in the interview. Really. Another frequently asked question is, what is the difference for and EXEC? We will see later. By the way, what's the difference? Well, you use, right? The probe and EXEC, system call. It's a system call, yes.
Probe is the second of processing from the execution file. That is like another call.
Probe is for multiprocessing.
Yeah, like multiprocessing.
When do you use the probe and EXEC system call? when you
have processing for the core, five core, they
create a process. What does that mean, creating process? For example, you execute the file, either double click or the command line, you execute the program, right? That means execute the software. In other words, create a new process. How can you create a new process? Copy. Make the clone of me. I'm the process. I'm the shell programming. Or I'm the desktop process. For example, current process. I can solve for you. You are the user. So if you double click one of the program, first I'm going to copy me. Okay? Then allocate the separate resource, memory area. Okay? We will see the details of the data structure of the process. Then make them separate. Okay, that is the EXEC execution. So hook and EXEC is the basic and most important system for we will see soon. So this is the storage device hierarchy. This one slow. That one is the faster. Register is, where is the register? Where can you find the register? CPU, processor. It's also storage, okay? It's also storage. What about the caching in between main memory and the register?
Isn't there one on the CPU and then also
for what?
On the memory?
It's also cache purpose. L2 cache or L2 cache 4 megabyte, 8 megabyte in the CPU. It's even not nowadays the main memory is slower comparing to CPU speed. We need a faster device that is a storage area in the CPU. The bigger is the better, not always. If you have the 32-bit and 64-bit processing. 64-bit, generally 2 times faster than 32-bit? No, it's more complicated. So, not always the bigger size of the such a cache area is better? No, not always. So you need to find optimized size. So that is the caching. Also, operating system has the direct memory access structure. When we read the data, the controller does interrupt the CPU. Then this data directly sent to the CPU? No, it should go to the memory. However, to go to the memory, operating system should take care of all of this. So what if the without controlling of the operating system, because once we access the data, we can, it's kind of a stream, series of the data. So direct memory access structure to increase the speed of input and output. So we will see details later how to make it. So this is a simple diagram to explain it. From CPU to the device, a sum of the data. First, memory is directly access the memory, the DMA, get the data. What if we have the not only just one CPU, but multiple processor. Okay, is it good? So we put as many processor as possible. Not always. It's not that simple. Because of
memory
complexity. When you have the two process, you can simultaneously process 2 job. That's okay. What about I have the very complicated, very heavy process. So I'd like to get the benefit of two processor. It's a different story. For example, we have the binary search. How does it work, binary search? Cut in half and compare whether this is bigger or smaller. And cut in half, bigger or smaller, and eventually you find it. So, what if when you use one CPU and two CPUs, which one will be faster? For binary. Even though you have the two CPU, it's a linear. Algorithm itself is a linear process, right? One, until you got the result of the first step, whether this is a big one. If we need access simultaneously, this one compared to this one, we can get the benefit of that. Otherwise, one CPU will be either, or the one CPU will be, you know, to process this one. So even though you have the multiple processor, that doesn't mean always you can get the full benefit of that. So that's the two others that has been discussed a lot, whether distributed system is always the good solution. To get the full benefit of the distributed system, your application should be uniformly distributed. Also, your data is distributed. And your algorithm can be, should be able to distribute it. And you can get the full benefit. Otherwise, it may cause, because if you separate the job between two CPUs, you need to communicate, make the consistency of the data. If the I is changing here, this is another CPU should know the value of I. So you need to keep communicating, update, that may cause the problem, even slower. So multiple process. So nowadays, some personal, the computer PC, they use the multi-core. Multi-core is a little bit different. I think that we have this one. So multi-core is in one CPU, it can process two set of instructions. So also, they share the memory, okay? They each core has their own cache, but it's connected to the memory. However, multi-process is each CPU device has their own the cache and access to the memory. The basic idea is the same. Cluster system is either multi-core or the multi-CPU is the one system, which means it has a CPU, memory, and hard disk drive. We have another node. But this time, hard disk drive can be shared using storage area network. Okay, but in terms of each computer, each node, it doesn't look like the external hard disk drive because of the faster media like the fiber optics. But CPU and the memory is not shared. Some of the system shared memory system can share the memory using memory channel. Very, very high speed memory channel, they share the data in the memory. Very, very expensive. Also, not frequently used. So most of the distributed system or cluster system has their own shared nothing. But nowadays, even the hard disk drive sharing is considered as a shared nothing. This is the cluster system. So cluster system has been used a lot so far to process huge jobs, such as data warehousing or whatever. However, the problem of the traditional cluster system is it's very hard to manage. And also, very hard in terms of programming. Is there anyone who took the parallel processing, the program parallel programming. We have a parallel programming course taught by the Hashem. It's not easy. Your algorithm should be changed, as I gave you the example of the binary steps. Okay? It should be changed to get the full benefit. So, but it's very expensive. Another benefit of the using cluster system is when you have a multiple node, even though one of the node is down, entire system will be fine. So, fault tolerance system, that's what manufacturers said. Real story is, in case one of the node is down, you cannot use your entire system. Yes.
What are the minimum nodes for the cluster?
It can be one.
That's a cluster.
It can be one.
If it can be one, why?
Yeah.
We
so one is the pseudo cluster, which means you can pretend for developing purpose. So you can build a cluster from the 2, 3, 4, 5, but usually the 2 to the power of the certain number is recommended. So it doesn't matter, no matter what the number you use for the number of nodes, so it can be cluster. Mm-hmm. Then, to address this issue nowadays, there's a new, very hardish, big data system, such as Hadoop. Okay. So they try to address the problem of the traditional system, such as partial tolerance or difficulty of the programming. And so this is nowadays the one of the solution to build a cluster system, the Hadoop system. One time, I offered the distributed data system course several years ago, which I closed, no more offer. At the time, we built a high performance computing, HPC, using the PS3. I think that you can see one of the poster that I implemented. Right now, I'm using that PS3 for my son's gaming, Minecraft. At the time, it's still the Navy, they use the PS3, 2000 PS3, PlayStation 3 for high performance computing. The main problem of the HPC, the PS3 based HPC is it has the, you can use only 250 megabyte memory. So it has a small, because the PS3 is not for computing, it's for gaming console. So they do not have, they have very powerful IBM PC, IBM processor. And it has the uh, 256 graphic memory. But main memory is 256. So it's quite small, but you can successfully install the cluster operating system. At the time we used the Fedora 12. Cluster, and also we installed the MySQL distributed database and successfully passed the system. So, operating system structure is basically based on the multi-programming and time sharing, multitasking, okay? Because we need to share, because we have a limited resource. So, what is a multi-program? I think that you know the time sharing, right? Time sharing means, so even though we have the one CPU, we can share, this one is for process A. Then there's an IO wait. IO wait means nothing CPU can do. So it's just a stop. During that time, we can use process B, like the switch, the CPU. Okay? That is a time sharing. What is a multi-programming? How many process, how many program can you run on your laptop? As many as possible. Probably limited, but you can run. Multi-programming. programming means multi jobs, multi process. It's the same name. So multi programming is a batch system. It's you can run the many job, many program. The problem you need to coordinate. That is the job of operating system because you have limited resources. Who is in charge of that? Scheduling. Job scheduling or CPU scheduling. Okay. How can we schedule?
The kernel.
Always first in, first out is the first solution. People. Okay? That makes sense.
But
what else you can imagine?
Priority. Like
priority, you can consider the priority. Actually, frankly speaking, all the such a scheduling algorithm is based on priority. What about the first in, first out? Arrival time is priority, right? So also, you can think about what else? So we will see later in details. So this is a multi-programming.
This slide explains it. So we have the 1, 2, 3, 4 jobs, okay?
4 process at the same time. Unfortunately, CPU cannot handle, cannot process all 4 same time. So using multitasking, time sharing can maximize the CPU resource and take care of the multiple jobs. So we are ready to talk about the third problem. So dual mode. Okay, so let me finish after explaining the dual mode. Dual mode means in the operating system. So operating system is not for single user, it's a multiple user. Okay? So but when you make the program, application program, you probably do you code the entire program nowadays? Mostly you use API, built-in library, right? What about the system programming also? System program means that you can build a CPU scheduler or the algorithm at the time. Do you need to implement all the things? No, you can focus on the algorithm by using system library, okay? So there's no program that can code from A to Z every. You use existing library or the system library, system API, or system call. At that time, such a system call will be taken care by the operating system. That is the kernel mode. Why? Application part, your own algorithm part, is managed by the user. So it's divided into two modes. Your process, your program, is the first start from the user mode, it's managed by the user. Then once you need to use the system resource, the system operating system is take over the job. Then it's a process status is changing to the system mode, kernel mode. Okay? Why? Why we make such a complicated
priority?
Priority,
yeah.
And system protection, okay? Because even application program need to access system resource, right? If you allow all the user, any program to access the all the system resource, many people try to get the, most of the application try to get the first priority, whatever, so it will be messed up. So for system protection purpose also, to consider such a priority or the order or whatever, so we consider such a different mode, system mode. Okay, let's take a look at this one. In case first user process is created, it's still user mode, but once you need to use system library, system API, system call, then the mode is changing into the kernel mode. Then this time kernel mode system is in charge of to process this one. Once it's done, and you can, for example, I'd like to create the child process from your process. But you cannot process it. You cannot create it. Instead, ask to the kernel. Kernel will create, because it required to access the resources, system resources, memory, and so on. So this kernel definitely has the permission to create and return. There's the address of the memory where your request is processed. Your process is created. So then you can, your user process will focus on user, the algorithm part. Okay, that is the kernel one. Okay, so let's start here. Next week, we will have the class on Tuesday and Thursday. There's no canceled class because Labor Day is a Monday, so we will see on Tuesday at the time. We will continue the introduction of the canceled.